We're ready for panel four, Building Better Brains. Judy, Frank, you've been waiting patiently, please. Chip, my dear friend, Chip. All right. And now it's to a very, very exciting panel on building better brains.
Okay, everyone can get seated. We'll try to get started and figure out how to build better brains. Yes, right. Step one. Okay. All right. This is our fourth panel today. I can't believe how fast the day has gone by. Before we get started, is Virginia here? Maybe she's not here, but the young lady that has been doing the visualization, I think we all owe her a round of applause. Hopefully you've had the opportunity to appreciate some of the remarkable work that she's been doing, capturing the millions of ideas that have been coming out of the brains here today. Okay, so our fourth panel is about building better brains, and I'll just briefly summarize it. Trauma of all kinds inevitably leads to more trouble and instability down the road. We've seen that happens, and trauma, unfortunately, is contagious. This not only sabotages individuals, it accumulates, and it can impair whole societies. It gets spread, and that happens at great human and economic cost that we probably don't always think about. And if we can agree that children are the futures of our societies, are we mortgaging the future if we allow them to come to any harm? And wouldn't the future be more promising if we could protect them by nourishing their brains? So one of the things that we want to try to explore here is how do we measure the damage and how do we build on the knowledge that we gain from that so that we can build better brains in the future. I have, again, four terrific panelists. Judy, I almost called you Sue. Judy Cameron, Francesco Branca, Frank Overclade, and I'm going to try to pronounce Andrea's name, Andrea Denese. Denese. I could be here all afternoon trying to pronounce it. But instead, we'll move forward. Actually, Judy has a plane that she's got to try to catch. So we're going to start with Judy. And you've done some really thought-provoking work with primates and monkeys and childhood that show the short and long-term effects, of trauma. So what can you tell us about your work and how it, connects with human children?
Well, if we put the first slide up, what I'm going to try to do is talk to you in 3.5 minutes, let's say, about a number of years of work we've done in non-human primates. And then I'm going to spend the last minute or two talking about what are we doing now in people? How are we trying to apply what we've learned in monkeys for children? So in this set of studies I'll talk about, we use non-human primates, very much like Steve Sumi suggested. However, these animals were reared in social groups that had animals of varying ages, so more like a family structure. And then the stress they experienced was that the mother was removed from the group at very specific times during development. And you won't be surprised, based on everything you've learned today, to hear that the timing of taking the mother away and experiencing that stress made all the difference in the world. You got different outcomes when you removed the mother at different times. The baby stayed in the social environment throughout development. So what you see in the top left-hand graph is a baby being held by its mother, close ventral contact. The baby's being snuggled. Steve showed a very good picture of that. Over the first 6 months of life, baby monkeys are born already knowing how to walk. The mother holds them, and they nurse quite a bit during the first month, but that progressively decreases, and they explore the environment and play with other monkeys. If you take the mother away when the baby is 1 week of age, the baby's just fascinated by the environment. It explores a lot. Other monkeys try to pick it up, but it isn't so interested in being picked up. So you see that it has almost no social interaction. And later in life, what's shown in the bar graph down below is that it will show less social interaction still. This is very different than if you take the mother away 3 weeks later when the baby is 1 month of age. Then the baby misses its mother. It goes through a period where it's not interested in being picked up by other animals. But very shortly, within the first month, it will start to seek social behavior. And for the rest of its life, it will seek social behavior at a higher level than normally developing monkeys. So, two types of early life stress with the opposite effects, depending on the timing. In collaboration with Karoli Marinix, we started to look at gene expression in the brain. And what you're looking at in the figure that's surrounded by a blue background is gene expression in control animals. They have their mother removed at 6 months of age, which is about the time of mating for rhesus monkeys, and so a fairly normative period of development. And we've arranged 200 genes in the amygdala such that the highly expressed genes are red and the genes that are expressed at low levels are blue. Then the middle panels in vertical columns are 1 week separated animals. And you see that there's a radical difference between gene expression in these 200 genes. They look just the opposite. The 1 month separated animals are the last four columns, and they look different from both groups. So we've also done work looking at how the neurons connect to each other, and they connect differently. So the structure of the brain is changed by this life experience. The gene expression later in development is changed. We're all about interventions here today. And so the boxed-in graph at the bottom talks about an intervention. We gave a super mom. In our primate colony, we have mothers that will readily adopt babies. And we paired a super mom with the group. In the animals where the mother was paired right away, or in the first month after the separation, and these are 1 week separated infants, very readily the baby bonded with the mother, and the mother spent a lot of time with the baby throughout development and showed normative development. If you waited to 35 days, that's just 10 days past a month, that's the light blue line. The mother was effective, but not as effective. And if you waited to 45 days, that's the orange line, it was just the same as not giving a mother back at all, which is the red line. So there was a timing of the effect of the experience, but there was also, and very importantly, the timing of the intervention matters. Interventions that happened, we think, while the brain systems are still plastic, were effective. If you got past that point, the intervention, even though this was a very attentive mother and she was there for a year, didn't change the baby's behavior. So I think as a group, we need to think about the timing of intervention. We're now taking this because after years of talking about this kind of work and really trying to convince, I spend a lot of time talking to legislators about why it's important to pass laws that are good for child development, we decided we need to try to really do this on the ground in Pittsburgh. So the Homewood region of Pittsburgh is a low-income, underserved area. About 70% of the adults don't have jobs. About 65% are living below the poverty line. And we are taking programs to them. What are we doing based on this monkey work? Well, we know that different parts of the brain develop at different times. You've heard that from a lot of people today. We know that you need to intervene early. But children are much more complicated than our monkey experiments. They experience stresses at many, many times during development. So what that told us is you need to have a system in place where interventions can be instituted right away when the problem happens, and that they can be specific to whatever part of the brain is developing at the time that the child experiences the stress. Well, that's tough. You really need the environment the child is growing up in to have adults that know how to intervene. They know about neuroscience. So there we are. We're in the Pittsburgh community and we're teaching neuroscience, and we need to teach a lot of people about this. Who are we using to teach that to and kind of be the people who spread the word? We've decided to use retirees, and we have now a whole army of retired citizens, but these are people who worked in a community where very many people are not working. People who worked are very important. They know their way around the community. They care about the community. They're part of the community. And they are learning neuroscience and very eager to do so from us. We are then pairing them with young children so that they can help with school readiness. And I think it is starting to work. So I think animal work is important, and we're still doing animal work. And we're very interested in things like how to open the plastic period and make it a little longer. We're not using drugs, we're using exercise, but I'm out of time.
Thank you. Yes, that's time is our enemy today. But Dr. Branca, I hope that your work, we've discussed nutrition a lot today, and that's the area that you're working in, right? So help us out.
Thank you, Jim. Well, I'd like to start with the good news, and that's that the deaths of children under five have decreased from the 12 million that we were counting in 1990 to 6.9 million in 2011. However, do all the children, the surviving children, do all the living children get the opportunity to get to the whole human potential? Are they able to really become the actors of sustainable development? And we estimate that, unfortunately, there's about 200 million children who have impaired growth of development. So that's really the number of the magnitude of the issue we're talking about. We heard a lot, as you said, Chip, about nutrition today. And nutrition really has a two-way relationship with early childhood development. On the one hand, we know that children with poor health and nutrition are at risk of poor development. The other hand, we know that psychosocial stimulation is a component of health and nutrition intervention. In other words, good stimulation will improve nutrition. Now, I think the important element here is to understand how we measure also the early childhood development. And I think this is a challenge, because we have to measure, as we heard today, many different things in many different moments of the life course. So I thought I will just show you what the tools I have, and those are the nutrition fears. And these are the global nutrition challenges. You see, in fact, the icons there are there because the World Health Assembly agreed on certain global targets, so they agreed that those are the issues to challenge in the next 15 years. Don't change the slide, just go back to the initial one, thank you. So the numbers here you see, 162 million stunted children in 2012. Now we know that stunted children, particularly those who are stunted before the age of two, will also have poor cognitive and educational outcomes until they are children and until they are adolescents. I mean, they have problems, for example, in language ability. They have problems in schooling. They can fail grades more than others. In fact, there's an estimate that stunted children get at least 1 year less schooling. And then, even in the longer term, they would be adults who earn less. I mean, there's an estimate that they earn 20% less. So that's the stunting. But then we also heard about maternal nutrition. So the second one is about anemia. And we have 496 million non-pregnant women plus 32 million pregnant women with anemia. And anemia in women is going to lead to children with also impaired development, poor responsiveness, lower IQ, and then even impaired motor functioning in children. Then the next one is intrauterine growth retardation. And we heard about early developmental risk of children born with intrauterine growth retardation. Breastfeeding. We heard a lot today about breastfeeding. And, you know, I put the negative number there. So we know that 38% of children are exclusively breastfed up to the age of 6 months. But that means that 62% of the children, the majority of children, is not having access to this very essential biological intervention and are therefore at an increased risk poor development. We know that breastfeeding has good effects on development and educational attainment as well. And finally, wasting. 51 million wasted children under five, and we know that weight gain between 0 and 2 years is associated with schooling and risk of, again, failure at school. So all the nutrition challenges there, in fact, back about one, are associated to poor development. And now you can press the button, thank you. And you see there's a commitment to actually, by all member states, to reduce this different conditions. Just press, please, several times, 40% less that the children, reducing by half anemia, reducing the intrauterine growth retardation, low birth weight, increasing exclusive breastfeeding, and reducing wasting. But there's another one, and please press once again. And the last global challenge is actually obesity, and we haven't really spoken about it. Andrea is going to talk a bit about that, about the connection also with that poor that aspect of malnutrition. I mean, a malnourished child can also be obese. So I'll just close there by saying, you know, these are major challenges in the world, and these are elements that so far have characterized our attempt to achieve Millennium Development Goals in 2015. Most likely they are going to be also on our agenda for post-2015. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Frank, I wonder if you could, I mean, one of the big challenges we face is to somehow measure the effect of both damaging and enriching experiences in children. But in Australia, you've already made some progress along these lines with the Australian Early Development Index. So what can you tell us about that?
Thanks. I'd just like to make 4 points. Starting off, Jack showed a slide this morning of the different interconnected parts of the brain and made the correct point that all the bits and pieces are interconnected with each other, yet we still measure outcomes independently. You know, we measure cognitive outcomes, we measure behavior, we measure nutrition as if they're separate things. And so I guess the first thing is how can we develop a holistic measure of development that incorporates what we know about neuroscience? I should also say I'm not a neuroscientist. I'm a pediatrician who doesn't do neuroscience research. I actually do clinical and translational research, so that I'm a little bit intimidated by all the neuroscientists here. So the first thing is, how do we broaden the measurement beyond just single issue things? The second thing is, the measurement has to be meaningful. There's no point collecting data just for the point of collecting data. And as long as we use narrow outcomes, we don't bring into the discussion lots of people who are uninterested in those outcomes. So in our country, we've got some very good longitudinal data, representative data on behavior, on language, on cognitive ability, all showing delays. But the only people interested in that are the speech pathologists who are interested in language and the behavioral people interested in behavior. It excludes a whole lot of other people that really should be around the table. We thought we were making pretty good progress in advocacy in Australia. We had some good innovative policy, but we were sort of doing what colleagues around here were doing, little bits and pieces. Some government ministers were sort of getting interested, but very narrow pockets of interest. And what really changed things, what really tipped, we got to the tipping point when we had these data. This is the Australian Early Developmental Index, which is a general measure of health and well-being when a child starts school, so around about the age of 5, and it's completed by teachers during the first year of the child's formal schooling. We don't analyse data for individual children. We aggregate them, feed them back to communities as maps, and we give quantitative data, et cetera, et cetera. And that's really changed the social discourse, because it's brought into the discussion not just those people who are interested in the narrow outcomes, but it's brought people to the table who normally wouldn't be there. So school principals, teachers, health professionals who look at the data, 1 in 5 Australian children, high-income country, are arriving at school already in trouble. So suddenly school principals in the education system, who up until a couple of years ago weren't interested in engaging in a discourse about early childhood, now sitting up and taking interest. And they're our strongest supporters now, because they're saying, look at the shape these kids were in before they got to school. So they've focused a huge amount of interest now on early childhood. People in the community are interested, community managers. So it's brought to the table people that wouldn't have been there, because they can relate to these outcomes, because they're broad and holistic. The other thing relevant to that is, how do we mainstream the conversation about early childhood development? And we have to move beyond, I believe, terms like poverty and disadvantage, etc. We know services for the poor tend to be poor services. And again, it means that if I'm not poor, or I don't have responsibility for poverty or for disadvantage, I don't need to engage with that. It's out there. It's not my business. So I think the challenge is to broaden the outcome measures and measure it in such a way that everybody relates to it, that early childhood development and the problems become everybody's business. And that means we have to move beyond targeting. We've targeted for 100 years and it hasn't worked. When are we going to stop targeting? We think we can get better targets and better interventions. We have to go beyond targeting to mainstream. And the final point I want to make is around the life course research. I think in addition to the genomics and the exciting genetics research, I think the life course research is very exciting for us. It's getting increasingly robust. And that engages the adults. And those of us who have been doing pediatrics, child health doesn't appear on radar screens of policymakers. It's not a rounding error in the health budget. It never gets up there at all. But those concerned with adult health and adult chronic illness are now looking at the life course research, and suddenly they're getting interested in biological markers in the early years as well. So I think that's the other challenge. So to summarise, I think the data have to be meaningful, they have to be broadened so everybody owns those data and everybody has a responsibility. I think they need to be mainstreamed. We have to move away from poor countries, poor regions, poor communities, to make it everybody's business. And I think there's a really exciting opportunity to engage our adult colleagues now, because so many adult conditions start in pathways that begin in those early years.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, final panelist is Andrea.
You've done work on inflammation and obesity and linked them to abnormal brain function. We were talking about this last night. This is fascinating. So maybe it's just, you know, take off from there and tell us what your work's about.
Sure, thanks. I thought it would be interesting, after hearing all this discussion about brain development, to think also about the broader, perhaps even more surprising consequences that stress in children may have on physical health. And I think today we had marvelous examples of how the brain and the body are linked into a two-way interaction. That also, of course, opens the possibility that psychosocial experiences might influence how the body functions. And in particular, I think there is now increasing evidence that stress in childhood may give, may lead to short-term adaptations that are effective at the time of stress exposure, but may lead to detrimental longer-term consequences. So this really, I think, fits well with the theoretical framework that we have just set up. And I wanted to give two examples of this. The first one is with inflammation. Inflammation is an ancient component of the immune system that allows us to mount a very rapid but non-specific response to pathogens that are common in the environment that we have been living with for evolutionary times. So rapid and non-specific. This means that acutely is a truly vital response to have because it prevents spread of infections and also improves healing processes in the body. However, in the longer term, because of the non-specific nature of the response, inflammation may actually be detrimental. This is because not only inflammation may react against pathogens, but can also react against our own body. And in fact, I think there is now very solid research linking inflammation to chronic age-related conditions such as heart disease, type 2 diabetes, and even dementia. Now, inflammation can not only be activated by infections or tissue damage, can also be activated by psychosocial stress. So stress really can be seen as an alarm signal telling our body that potential physical damage is imminent. And therefore, in that light, might trigger an inflammatory response to prepare the body to face infections. If stress happens early in life, though, this may have detrimental consequences in the longer term. So if we can go back once, please, on the slide. On this slide, I show some of the initial evidence that we gave a few years back now about the association between childhood maltreatment and adult inflammation. And in subsequent research, we also have seen that already in children that are exposed to maltreatment, we have we can see elevated inflammation levels. These are things that we can measure in the blood at early age, already in childhood. So already in childhood, we have evidence that stress mounts short-term, potentially beneficial response in the context where the environment is threatening and unpredictable. However, these short-term adaptation may lead to detrimental longer-term consequences with inflammation high in adult life. And as we know, therefore being potentially one of the mechanisms through which exposure to maltreatment may lead to medical outcomes such as heart disease, type 2 diabetes, and potentially dementia. There is also another good example. This next example is about, again, the situation where we are in a condition that is threatening and unpredictable. In that situation, and particularly if we want to support this heightened defense against bacteria and infections, we need to accumulate energy. It's very important that we eat more, we get more calories from what we eat, and we actually burn less calories, we do less physical activity. In the context of this second prediction, so the prediction that maltreatment may be associated with accumulation of energy, we undertook a couple of years ago a meta-analysis, that is, we pulled together a number of studies that have asked the question whether or not maltreatment in childhood is associated with obesity. And if I can have the next slide, thank you. You see a brief summary of the results. So what you see in those black points are the single studies that have looked at this very question. With colleagues found 41 studies looking at the very question, and by pulling together, by adding up studies and weighting them for the extent to which they were able to measure the effect precisely, we ended up observing that in a population size of nearly 200,000 people, we had a significant increase of risk of obesity in maltreated versus non-maltreated individuals. An effect that is perhaps more evident in adulthood than in childhood. So this is another example where a short-term strategy that might be effective in situations that are threatening, may become detrimental in the longer term. We know that obesity, of course, is related to inflammation, but more importantly, perhaps, just to take a broader picture in the discussion today, we know that obesity and inflammation are very much related to mental health outcomes, as we have been discussing, such as anxiety, PTSD, and depression. So I think, in closing here, we are accumulating growing knowledge about the fact that not only we have consequences of early life stress that impact on mental health, but this could be broader and perhaps more surprising, as I said, and also interest physical health. And short-term strategies may turn out to be detrimental in the longer term. And finally, I think that what we're doing here, thinking about mechanisms, thinking about causes through which exposure to stress and disadvantage in childhood may lead to outcome, really is the key to understand how to prevent these processes before the onset of truly clinical outcomes and medical disease. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, well, we have a lot to try to pull together. I had a couple of questions for you, Frank, just because I wanted to understand better, and maybe everybody else already does, but I don't. When you say mainstreaming, you know, what you mean? I mean, you seem to be talking about breaking down walls, both, you know, in terms of how we tackle problems and how we communicate problems and communicate with one another.
Number one, but also in the way we tackle those problems. That I'm talking about a universal rather than a targeted approach. As long as we're talking about poor kids or kids with problems or kids we need to fix up, I'm not interested because I just do mainstream health. It's out there and there'll never be enough funds for that. And I think, at least in our country, but I think most countries that I've been to, any system of healthcare delivery outside mainstream isn't working, whether it's child abuse, whether it's mental health, whether it's disability, because it's out there and I don't relate to it, I just do mainstream health. So we have to find ways of both developing a language that I own that problem, it's not out there. Child abuse is a perfect example that traditionally child abuse is bad people doing bad things to kids. Mm-hmm. So that's not my problem, it's out there, there's legislation, there are people that fix that up. Until we understand that we're all potential child abusers, that there's a spectrum of family stress.
Right.
And some people don't have the skills to cope with that stress, they abuse their kids. Until we mainstream it in that way, it's always going to be a problem. We'll never reduce it, there'll never be resources. And I think it's the same with early childhood development. Until we say it's everybody's business, it's not just those people who work in poor communities and those people that deal with problems. That's what I mean by mainstream. We have to find a language where everybody comes to the table, not just those people engaged in that. And then we have to have policy that mainstreams it, and then services that mainstream it as well.
Right, right, got it. Okay, and to quickly follow up, there was another term that you used, life course, yes. Which I get, I think, but you know, can you talk about that a little more and how you think that can help mainstream?
Sure. Well, there's an increasingly robust research that says that many, many problems we see in adult life have their origins in roots that begin in the early years. And what's exciting about this, not exciting but disturbing, I guess, is the range or the diversity from mental health problems to obesity to cardiac disease through to crime participation mm-hmm. and welfare dependency and family violence. And waiting until those problems become established and then trying to treat them doesn't work. They're not scientific solutions, they're political solutions. So right. All the evidence now is accumulating that if we want to tackle those problems in adult life, we have to get the early years right. And I think, again, finding a language to engage those people interested in adult conditions is a way we can bolster our area as well.
Got it. So really that relates directly to what you're talking about. It's the flip side of it, really, right? I mean, you're looking at life course statistics and saying they start back at the beginning.
Right, yes, absolutely. I think we are learning from long-term cohort studies that these effects are there. And I think what we're also progressively accumulating is knowledge that is very important because, as I said, these are observational studies. That is, naturally, we don't want to expose children to adversities. We just observe what adversities are associated with. Mm-hmm. But I think we are getting to the point where we can test those hypotheses much more carefully than we were able in the past. For example, we can carry out systematic analysis across studies to see whether different studies using different measures converge to similar results. We can more precisely measure confounders, that is, alternative explanation about why maltreated children may have health consequences,
right,
for example.
Right.
And I think also very relevant to this more scientific inquiry is the work that Judy and Steve are doing in animal models, where we can experimentally manipulate the environment and then see what the effect is.
Right.
We will always need to also have human studies to see whether that's relevant to us and also what's the size of the problem. Yeah, because effectively, at the end, we will have to balance the size of the problem to the size of the money
the
or the investment, the effort you want to put
to
in.
To resolve it. Yes,
yeah, can I Francesco? Comment on this one, actually? I think this is a very important point because I hope we don't have the understanding that this is an issue for only some countries of the world. But this is a global issue.
Yes.
And
absolutely.
It is an issue, really, but also in more and more in our world, in the rich world,
yes.
It's an issue certainly for certain socioeconomic strata, and we know that actually the disparities are increasing. Mm-hmm. So we have an increasing proportion of the population in the rich world which are affected by these issues. And I think that's a completely different way than to leads us into a different mode when we consider the actions to be taken. It is definitely an action on the environment. So it's not something which can only be delivered through services.
Mm-hmm.
So as you were saying, I mean, it's not targeting. It's, you know, it's changing the policy environment. It's making it into a public health really approach.
Yeah, a broad public health issue that the whole society has to address, not just those people.
Let me play the devil's advocate here, and I'm all with you. I definitely advocate for population level strategies. On the other hand, I think that we can give people a lot of money, but if they don't know what to do with it, they will do bad things. And on the other hand also, I think that we need to be thoughtful about when we want to intervene. What I mean by it is that I think, as we have discussed today, many of these examples of social disadvantage come into cycles. They don't just come randomly to people. There are generations of family that have been exposed to disadvantage.
Right.
So I think that we need to think where and how to also break those cycles. And in economy, they have the Pareto paradox, or the 20-80 paradox, which says that you could, in some cases at least, target a small proportion of the population that accounts for most of the risk. And if we can identify those, we may have very effective and cost-effective interventions to break that cycle.
Okay, so you know, how does the work that you're doing, I'm thinking of Homewood, is that what you were thinking of talking
right.
about? You know, how does that fit in with what we're talking about here?
Well, we've been very, very interested in your findings, for example, and yours too, that there's an increase in obesity in kids who've experienced early life stress. And we've been studying obesity for quite some time in monkey populations. So I'm again going to kind of give an example of how you might take a scientific finding and look at how could it be applied to a population of people who could benefit from it. So in monkeys, we studied what were the factors that were most likely to lead to obesity. And we started publishing papers on this in about 2006. Without a doubt, in every case, it's due to sedentary behavior. And so what we always see is there's a strong correlation between being sedentary and being overweight versus eating more. In fact, individuals who are very active in monkey terms, but this has also been shown for people, I can actually eat quite a bit of food. So you see very poor correlation between weight and food intake.
Yeah.
That said, you want to increase activity to get them to burn calories. So we started doing a whole series of studies looking at effects of exercise on the brain. Who's changing? You increase activity, is it just a peripheral effect? Or are there systems in the brain changing? And again, there's huge changes in the brain. There are thousands of genes in the brain that change expression, and there are changes in blood flow to the brain, delivery of oxygen, delivery of calories, and we've shown that it's very neuroprotective. So we decided it would be really good to incorporate into the work we're doing in Homewood an increase in activity. That would be neuroprotective for the adults who are actually helping the kids who are facing an increase in neurological diseases and need the neuroprotection, but it would also be good in the developing children. We've shown in young monkeys that it'll increase alertness, increase attention. And that's exactly what you want if you want them to learn something. So we've incorporated a new game that we've developed where it's done with the senior's iPhone. They basically mark an area, an environment, with symbols like stars and question marks. And the child explores the environment looking at the finder in the phone. When it sees a question mark, the adult gives them a problem to solve. So they're learning problem-solving skills, but they're out there exploring the environment. So I think
they're actually physically.
They're physically,
out there,
yeah.
Moving
they,
around.
What they do is they map out the neighborhood and they put on different domains these marks on the program. So it's got a
right.
map program. And
then they go there.
They go there. So they're getting exercise. Everybody's getting exercise. And the kids are getting problem-solving skills.
Yes.
Can I just respond to those two comments about the 80-20 and the program sounds wonderful. The ADI result, which is like a census of 98% of all Australian kids, you've got a greater chance of having problems if you grow up in a disadvantaged environment. But if you target only disadvantage, you miss most kids with problems. So your program sounds great for those you're working in a disadvantaged environment, they're needy kids.
Sure.
But what about all the obese kids in all the other areas that are experiencing stress, et cetera, et cetera?
Well, we would like to be working with all those kids too. And so I actually run science outreach for the University of Pittsburgh. We see 12,000 or more people a year. So we're seeing kids in many school districts. And what we would like to do is develop a program and test it in one place and then have it spread. Because you're exactly right. You have to come up with strategies to take this to scale. So this is a first test. But for me, it's a first test of taking the findings in monkeys to people. That's old hat for you.
I wasn't being critical for one moment of your program, but the beauty of early childhood development is that one intervention like exercise, reducing stress, can impact on a whole range of outcomes. Mm-hmm. And that's the attraction, that's the cost benefit of early childhood development. You can intervene. It's a lovely example of reducing stress by exercising. I bet you're improving cognition and behavior and all sorts of other areas as well.
Right.
And that's the point I was making, away from narrow measurements, narrow interventions towards broader social change. There's probably not a more cost-effective intervention, right through the life course than intervening with a program like that in early childhood.
Exactly.
And then we're going to open it up to questions.
Yeah.
In the back rows there.
I wanted just to share with you my congratulations for the initiative, but I'm very thankful for having given me another tool. I think my take-home message is that in a sense we're learning a new narrative of how to define health. So it's a better understanding of a more comprehensive way to consider it. I mean, with all the interactions that we have to think about, it's a global issue. It's a way to deal with the challenges of the next millennium. It's a way of addressing comprehensively several sectors, and the response to that as to be exactly in that direction. So I think we need to be thinking of delivering integrated packages in health, nutrition, care. I mean, we have said in the past, I mean, UNICEF has been always leading in developing this idea of care as a key component of nutrition and health interventions. I think we have some more ammunition in terms of advocacy there. Mm-hmm. We have greater understanding of the reason, the mechanism, and therefore we have the capacity to have better leverage to change that policy environment.
Okay, great, thank you. I think we have time for about one question, maybe two. Anyone in the back? I just want to try. Anyone? Okay, then Brock.
I'll keep it very brief. It's actually not a question. It's an appeal to UNICEF to listen to the message that I think Frank has expressed most eloquently, that what the neuroscience is saying has to be mainstreamed. Neuroscience is saying, we've got all these details, but it's up to society to use them, to own them, and to find the language, to have the conversation. And I think UNICEF are in a unparalleled position to take that message out. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Saul?
So, Dr. Frank, you mentioned an instrument and for evaluation. Which kind of instrument? How many domains does it measure?
The AEDI is an Australian adaptation of a Canadian instrument called the Early Developmental Instrument. It's got 100, our version is 104 questions that teachers complete online. It takes about 15 minutes per child, each teacher. There are five domains. Let me see if I can remember. Language communication, health and well-being, social interaction, etc. And it factors very, very nicely. We've done a lot of psychometric work, so it's a psychometrically very robust instrument. And we don't analyze it. It wasn't developed for an individual assessment tool. We aggregate the data, feed it back to schools, feed it back to communities in the forms of maps of vulnerability and well-being. And the beauty, it's in the public domain. So anybody can go in and look at those data and compare it to other communities. And as I said, that's really changed the social discourse in our country. That's not to say that everyone understands early childhood and wants to get involved, but suddenly people are at the table who normally would not have been there. And we have politicians now talking about data. Can you believe that? So, you know, no data, no problem, no solution. So in our experience, not just with the ADI, but even with local community data, the better the data, the better the profile a community can develop, not just for the well-being of children, but for all the other factors using the ecological model. It brings communities together, and there are surprises all over the place. There are disadvantaged communities that are doing, or disadvantaged neighbourhoods that are doing better than expected, and there are advantaged communities doing worse than expected. There are surprises all over the place. Mm-hmm. And people come together, why are we seeing these data? And asking the question why is the first step to then doing something about it. The other thing, if I can just have 10 more seconds, it's sure. Really, apart from the universal message, the importance of universal services, because middle-class communities have lots of kids with problems, it's really pointed the way to intervention, which has got to be place-based. There's a Chilean philosopher, Ernesto Galeano, who has a wonderful quote, "The only thing you build from the top down are holes."
That is so great.
It's a lovely quote. I've got a slide, and people always respond like that. So what these data show us is that if we're going to make a sustained change using evidence, using family-centered approach, it's got to be a community by community by community, because every community is different in terms of its demographics, its service configuration, its assets, et cetera, et cetera. So it's been a very, very powerful tool for us.
So I just one last question is, do you think that this has gotten people to the table? Because, I mean, you said no problem, no solution. Because in a sense, it created a new kind of problem. I mean, or redefined the problem and therefore got people to the table?
Well, I think the national data was surprising. Australia is a wealthy, high-income country. The fact that one in four kids are arriving at school already in trouble, you know, people sit up and take notice of that. And this, every jurisdiction I've been in, and I've spoken to colleagues, the education system is the hardest to engage. And our strongest supporters now are the schools, because principals, when they get beaten up for low achievement scores, are saying, no, look at the shape these kids were in before they came to school.
Right.
So suddenly the spotlight is on early childhood, so it's been fabulous.
Right. Judy has to leave. She has to make a plane, so I'm afraid we have to wrap up now at 4:15, and we're actually on time. So I want to thank all of the panelists today. Did a fabulous job. I feel so lucky to have just been here to even ask a question or two. Thank you so much. Now we're going to, you're going to have a final session. Okay, and we'll kind of wrap it up and a call to action, and then we'll move on to changing the world.
We're going to go into a closing panel in just a couple of minutes. And if you looked at the agenda, we had every panel very, very well defined except the closing. And that was by design, because we really wanted to know how the day would progress. And we really wanted to get a sense of where we would be at this time. And we wanted that last panel to be very organic. and something that would allow us to really build on the richness of the learning today. So we are going to go into the closing panel in just a couple of minutes. We have a minute or two to stretch our legs and just sort of listen in. The last part is going to be exciting. And just to let you know, after we finish our meeting, we have a reception upstairs at the room we call Danny K. It's a lovely space, and we really would engage and love and invite everyone to please join us upstairs for a more informal conversation to keep this going, because it's really been a day of tremendous learning and tremendous sharing, and I think there's a lot of questions we would like to ask of each other. So please do come up to Danny K at the end of this. So we're going to go into our closing session, and Mr. Lake has kindly agreed to start us in that direction by making a few remarks about his takeaways from the day, and then we'll open it up and get more responses from everyone. So, Mr. Lake, would you prefer to sit or the podium?
So, I don't need to hold it, do I? Can you hear me? Is it okay? Or should I hold it? Okay, thank you. I'll reserve 1 minute at the end to say thank you to everybody, although I could not be more grateful for everything, and I think this has just been absolutely extraordinary. But I'll save that for the end. But I do want to thank everybody who spoke for speaking in ways that even I could understand. I mean, it was quite extraordinary, and for everybody saying so much in so little time. I have not seen its like in this room before. And I want to thank you for all the phrases that I can steal and use as my own now when I'm talking on these issues. I think we have succeeded, and more than succeeded, in what I had hoped, I said at the beginning, that would come out of this, which is helping us create a scientific base for literally redefining early childhood development into broader and more holistic terms, and going beyond education to nutrition. And one thing that has really struck me is how often we came back to protection as well as education and how it links to everything else and getting over stress. I'm having trouble reading my notes here. I'm going to have to hold it up a bit. As you can see, it's not a reflection of an orderly mind. And I love the phrase that coming out of that, therefore, that this is everybody's business. Whoever said that, and it certainly is. Let me organize an effort at a summary and the main points that I took away into two sections of, first of all, why it's so important, because that goes to the issue then, and it was very, very helpful, of how UNICEF can not only, of course, do what one of the last interventions had said, about making the case for science and making the case for data-driven solutions, et cetera, which really was the purpose of the whole day, was to do precisely that. We will certainly be doing that. I like the phrase that somebody had, that science changes how people look at the world. And we will do our best to try to help accomplish that. So the appeal to UNICEF, I couldn't see who it was over on this side of the room, yes, was both very welcome and totally unnecessary, because that's why we're here, and we will do our best as we can, and not just us, but we will try to involve other partners and find ways to amplify what we heard. Some thoughts on the why, which can help us make the case for early childhood development seen whole. And then secondly, some hows, and how we can use this to do a better job in what we're doing. And the reason I wanted to go first was so that you all could then say what I meant to say, or what I should have said. So this is sort of a series of hypotheses of what I understood that are certainly disprovable. So on the why, it certainly is going to help us make the case for doing what we do on nutrition, protection, education, etc. There were many, many examples, and I won't try to run through them, of how stress, for example, affects kids, and how, as somebody said, trauma is contagious. We've gotten a lot of evidence that we will collate then afterwards on how this is all affecting kids, and therefore why we have to be doing what we're doing. One of the whys then was the point we began with, Jack, and that is that the argument is over as to whether it is nurture or nature, whether it is genetics or experience in the environment. And we will certainly be promoting that. But what I found very striking during the course of the whole day, and especially in the morning, was all the discussion of the connections between the two, which we hadn't focused on so much, going to the intergenerational memory, and how I had thought coming into today that it was simply that violence was replicated from one generation to the next because of learned behavior. But the effect actually on genetic makeup was something I had not expected and was extremely interesting. And that is a why, because it is going to allow us then, with a more factual basis, to make the case at how high the stakes are in this. That we are not only talking about the future of individual children, and we are not only talking about what happens to societies as a whole, but how, as it becomes replicated, then the stakes grow and grow and grow, and therefore this is all the more important than most people understand. Secondly, I have found in describing to people why stunting is so important that they, as you and I were talking about a little, that they tend to believe that if somebody is stressed or if there is a nutritional deficit or whatever, that it affects behavior as if behavior and feelings and all were somehow mysteriously contained in the body somewhere. But to be able to show specifically the physical effects, which you have also richly described, on the brain and on the body, immune systems or whatever, really drives it home with people and explaining to them why this issue is so important. You can see jaws drop when you do it. Especially here, I think it's not that hard to make the case on nutrition, because most people understand that, of course, nutrition will affect growth, including the growth of the brain. Although the examples from Chip's book and in many others of how much the energy that you consume from proper nutrition goes to the development of the brain is quite astounding. It's the, again, from today, going beyond nutrition to the effects, the physical effects of stress on the brain are going to be something that we can make a lot more out of, I think, in explaining why this is so important. I was thinking while you were talking about this in a number of times, an orphanage I went to in Guatemala 6 months, 8 months ago or so. And I walked by this little boy who was literally in a cage of his crib in this institution. And I walked by and he started crying. And I wondered what I had done wrong, so I walked back and looked at him and he stopped crying. So I walked away and he started crying again, and I walked back and picked him up, and I've never felt a being more wanting to be held. And I've been using that case since as a part of UNICEF's unrelenting drive against institutionalization of children in all circumstances. That is the worst outcome for children. I've been using that to illustrate simply that children need touching and love and therefore should be in families. Now I can talk about the physical effects, in fact, of the absence of what somebody called skin-to-skin contact. So that's going to be very useful in the why also. And then very interesting, especially this morning, a third thing on why, and that is the question of hopelessness and permanence. And I do apologize to everybody who ever heard me say that after 1,000 days, stunting is irreversible and permanent, and forget about it. Because on the one hand, that clearly is not the case, and there are ways to compensate. You can try to make up for some of it. But, and I come away with an even bigger but, as many of you described, the fact that it becomes progressively harder and harder and requires more and more energy to make up for a failure in the early stages to do the right things is a tremendous argument for not just working on these issues, but the urgency of working on these issues getting it early. So on the one hand, there is hope. And there is hope in fixing it right up through puberty, et cetera, et cetera. And I found a particular hope in the thought that if we could find enough rhesus monkey grandmothers and grandfathers and send them around the world, then we can even affect the genetic changes that take place from stress and violence. So, on the whys, again, this is going to greatly reinforce our ability to talk about the importance with a scientific base of why early childhood development, understood whole, is so important. Talk more about the physical effects of stress, lack of stimulus, et cetera, and that it is not hopeless, but it sure as hell is very important at early stages. On the hows, I think I invented a new word this morning called, as I was thinking about how do we look at all this more holistically, of holisticity. And how do we, can anybody correct me? Is that a new word, I hope?
Yes.
And it creates the illusion of scientific weight if I say holisticity. Anyway, what? Holisticity increases with age. Well, I'm glad something does, because I'm... Anyway. But I think we talked about two different kinds of holisticity. Have I mentioned holisticity recently? Yeah, just trying to get it into your mind. Anyway. My word. What?
It's a Wikipedia
already. It is? Good. Yeah, with my picture? Yes, good. Okay. Anyway, one kind of holisticity is temporal or chronological that we talked about in various stages during the day. It seemed to me that, and I was very struck by this, that when we talk about early childhood development, we shouldn't just talk about it in terms of the first days and months and few years after a child is born, but also in the fetus because of the genetic changes as well as other changes that can take place there. But going backwards chronologically, talk about the parents. And I was very struck by not only talking about the health, et cetera, of the mother, but also of the father. And that if a father is stressed, then there's going to be a genetic change, actually, in the child, which is fascinating. And then if you go forward again, if you start back there and then go forward through all the stages that we talk about, and we talked about this all the way up through puberty, and Gita, adolescent girls, et cetera, and then take it forward to when the girl and the boy, and then the young man and the young woman, we hope, give birth, then you have, I would have called it not so much in a way a life course, but a life circle. And we can start to describe this in that way and see it holistically in terms of, again, chronology. But then, of course, also where I began this with the seeing it holistically and cross-sectoral. And we had so many descriptions of this in so many ways of how the various issues are interconnected. I was particularly struck by the notion that growth, because I never thought of it this way before, that growth, as somebody said, is icing on the cake. And that after the baby body, at whichever stage, has compensated in its use of nutrition, his or her use of nutrition, for stress, for dealing with a lack of stimulus, and this was also a new thing for me, of looking on the brain, although it's in Chip's book, as a vacuum cleaner, looking for all kinds of the stimulus, and if you deny the stimulus, that becomes a form of stress. In fact, yes? Or did I misunderstand that? And then, after it's dealt with all of that, you can get the benefits of the nutrition, et cetera. So it's, the various aspects are connected in that. And thus, the importance, as we look at how to fix it, of play as well as education, as well as nutrition, et cetera, et cetera. So we found many examples that we can use then of how we all have to work on this in an intersectoral way. Or in a very much simpler form, as somebody said, very simply, there are multiple challenges and that requires multiple solutions and they have to be integrated in how we approach them. Finally, I noted for myself anyway a number, but I think they're really for many of you also, areas to explore. And to try to understand better. Defining, as the last panels were describing, defining outcomes in broader and more cross-sectoral ways, as in the AEDI, and looking at, because if you're not defining the outcomes in a more integrated way, you're never going to be approaching the solutions in a more integrated way. Second, we really did not get very far on whether progress in one area can help compensate for a lack of progress in another, and that I think requires more inquiry that I hope you all are going to be carrying out. Third, three interrelated things, the mapping of, better mapping of the sensitive and critical periods, to which will help us then maximize the effectiveness of our interventions. And it is, I think this is absolutely critical, and again, mapping them up through puberty rather than just making it early childhood. And secondly, targeting the different sectors of the brain and how we can target them best with different interventions, chemical as well as programmatic, but certainly we don't do the chemical part of it. And then third, and there was an interesting bit of an argument back and forth, I thought, on identifying populations that are most at risk here, because since we have limited resources, I would simply note, so with limited resources, you really have to do this, at least for a start, but the populations most at risk are not necessarily the poorest populations, and on, for example, obesity, et cetera. And then the main task is to relate all of those so that we're looking both at the critical phases and what are the most critical areas during that phase that we have to intervene in, and that I think a lot of work can be done. And then finally, very interesting discussions that need, at least that we at UNICEF need to think more about, is how the brain and the body interact in each direction over time, inflammation, et cetera, and the very interesting discussion of the role of exercise. And I raise that simply because the UNICEF exercise room is one floor directly below us, and I'd be glad to lend you my pass.
I'm not sure there's much more to add. That was an amazing, amazing summary of what occurred and what we know and what gaps are remaining. I don't know if any of our panelists here have closing remarks they'd like to make to UNICEF or to us, Sue. Oops.
I love the way that the red and the dress.
Yeah.
First principle, always wear the color of the chair.
Okay. All right, so I should.
Second principle is Pia rules, and I want to thank her because I have said this before. Anyone that could herd this many cats is an amazing person. We were not easy. This was, I thought, a fabulous meeting. I'd like to always put in my own plug for thinking from the bottom up rather than the top down. I think that message came from multiple sources. I'd like us to remember we evolved. We didn't just think ourselves up, imagine ourselves, and then exist. And when we know that, and the continuity between the human and every other organism on the planet puts us in a little less arrogant and a much healthier place to decide what to do next. And of course, we've got to support the babies being fed human milk in any way we can, and we've got to support the fact that that's going to allow the mother to be a better mother, and she needs to be supported by all other family members, fathers, other mothers, and so forth. So we're part of a very large and important network. And I think, biology is here to help us. It's not something that, I know Mr. Lake wasn't crazy about in high school, but, or so he told me. But
it wasn't crazy about me.
It was, I'm sorry. They asked him not to come, or something like that. But the point is that we've learned a lot in the last 60 years. We've got a lot to learn, but we are making progress. I don't find this meeting pessimistic at all. I think it's optimistic. I think biology is optimistic because it shows you that we have workarounds for almost everything. We may not be able to make me 6 foot tall, no matter how much food I eat. It seems to be going the other direction. But we have a lot. We can be, we, this generation can do something. So I feel good about this.
Thank you.
I'd just like to echo Sue's remarks and thank you for organizing it. And at the risk of repetition, just talk about the opportunity for UNICEF, because you do have the reach, you've got the brand name, you've got the credibility, you're in a unique position worldwide. I coined the term early childhood development as everybody's business. I did a seminar for the Melbourne Business School, and you can see the link, and then I wrote an article for their journal. Early childhood development is much too important to be left to early childhood people. And I think the challenge is to make it meaningful to everybody. So if you talk to a health minister, what's in it for health? If you talk to an employment minister, what's in it for employment? If you talk to a social welfare minister, you're talking about reducing welfare payments, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that's the challenge, to find the words. And I think UNICEF could really play a leading role in developing that language, making it available. And then it can be adapted in each country's need. It needs to be translated both linguistically, but also culturally, about making it everybody's business.
Thank you.
So I guess I'll pile on some of the things that have been said and maybe put one other different twist on this. So I mean, I know I speak on behalf of everyone here that we've all been to more conferences than we care to remember, but when the executive director of an organization spends the entire day here and doesn't just come and welcome you in the morning and then leave. And when all of the senior leadership and people, I don't know how many people I met from how many UNICEF pods out there all over the world, obviously there's an important thing happening at UNICEF right now. So for us, this is an incredible honor to be part of this event. And so I'd like to add just a kind of few other words about kind of what this might look like for UNICEF, really building on what everyone said. My experience has been, well, first I'll start with UNICEF. So I've always thought of UNICEF as standing on a very strong platform of a compelling moral imperative and a human rights issue for children. And the combination of a moral imperative and a strong science base is a pretty tough act to kind of counteract. And the other thing about the science is, we didn't get into that too much today, but this notion that somehow what happens early matters for your life, when you bring together science, a moral imperative, and what your grandmother could have told you, that's a really powerful kind of platform. So I think the excitement of this, I mean, this, those of us who really care about this issue love to think that we might be part of an historic transition at UNICEF. For me, the big issue would be that the early childhood field, and I totally resonate to what Frank and others have said about you don't want to segregate this, but this is a field that's been around for a long time, and for many people, this might be considered the victory that UNICEF is now embracing an early childhood agenda. For me, it's hardly the victory. It's like the first step to then say, so what are we going to do with UNICEF embracing this agenda and embedding it not in its own silo, but as part of a health and education, child protection, child welfare agenda. So I think what is really exciting is for the power and the place of UNICEF in the world for children is to kind of see, at least on the now what question, first, there's a science base that we spent the whole day talking about that applies everywhere in the world. I mean, for goodness sake, I mean, half the science comes from animal studies, right? So the science applies equally to all children everywhere in the world. But the application of the science and the what should we do and the how is very different depending upon context, right? So what you do in sub-Saharan Africa or South Central Asia or Latin America or North America or Australia or the Middle East is different. It's the same science, but the context really matters. And so I think the wonderful opportunity for UNICEF is to think of a kind of two major directions. One is there's a lot of stuff going on out there about early childhood, and what's critical is to identify what are the best practices out there, because not everything we're doing for young children is really grounded in good knowledge, and a lot of it is grounded in a particular preference for one way of doing things. And the other thing about the science is demanding. We talked about measurement, we talked about outcomes. This is not about paying attention to the needs of young children. It's making a big difference in their lives. So one issue is to identify best practices and decide how they get played out in all the different contexts in which children are growing up around the world. And the second, which is my pet interest, is also asking the question of what's next? What are we going to be doing 10 years from now and 20 years from now that is beyond what best practices are today? And I think many people see science as a way to build the case for investing in the things we're doing right now, the best of what we're doing, but science is sitting here waiting to drive new thinking, new ideas, new theories of change, new practices that by definition mean trying new things and having an environment that makes it safe to try new things based on scientific thinking and be allowed to fail and learn from failure and keep moving the ball down the road. Because in the end, it's about overcoming immense odds that have intergenerational grounding that will not be solved by a magic program and a magic bullet anywhere. And I think this is where UNICEF could, oh my goodness, UNICEF could like be out there as the organization in the world that is sitting on its kind of long tradition of a moral imperative and driving a science-based approach that is settling for nothing less than much bigger impacts than anything we've ever achieved, rather than celebrating the fact that we're finally focusing on young children. So it's just a real treat and honor to be part of this day, and I kind of want to thank all the UNICEF staff for giving us the opportunity to be part of this seminar. And the last thing I'll say about stress is that I can't help but say this because Chuck and others who I've worked with on this is that the problem is not stress, because stress is a normal part of life. And in fact, children need to learn how to experience and deal with stress. The problem is toxic stress. The problem is stress that disrupts developing brain circuitry and causes insulin resistance that gives you diabetes and accelerates atherosclerosis. So we don't want to fall into the trap of saying that children shouldn't experience stress. What we want to do is protect them and help build their capacity to deal with the challenge of stress, which is part of life. So thank you for the privilege of being part of this day. It's been great.
Thank you, John. Yes. Please go ahead.
I've noticed that toxic stress produces Yankee fans. But, never mind. What? No, not the stress never. No. In fact, I should say this. You shouldn't thank me for being here all day. Seriously, that's, if I may say so, ridiculous. Because this is the most fun I've had. Seriously, since the Red Sox won the World Series last year. No, really, it was just so much fun to listen and to learn and to have little, you couldn't see it because they're little invisible cartoon things, but little light bulbs going off over my head all day long as I suddenly, things that I sort of understood before, I really understood as I saw more of the science behind them. And it was terrific. And I think everybody from UNICEF felt the same way. Next steps. One is internally we're going to be working hard on how to, in various ways, break down the silos, see this whole, and raise early childhood development seen whole in ways that we'll be working on. But we also need to work now on the messages that can encapsulate this in ways that we can use with the scientific community at one level and the public, or at least the public that's willing to listen at another level, and we'll be working on that. And I hope that we can see this as the beginning of a kind of a virtual community in which we can stay in touch with all of you to be working on this. So you're not finished. And as you said very well, Jack, this is the beginning, I think, of something for us, and I hope for you, and that, and we know where you are, and we know your emails, and you are not escaping. And to disagree with one thing that you said, though, it's not just UNICEF, because more and more as an institution, we are trying to work in partnership with NGOs, as I said this morning, NGOs who work on Save the Children and others who work on these issues, faith-based organizations who have a great stake in this, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so besides this virtual community, we need to broaden it out into something approaching more of a movement. Let me then say, add to the shout out for Pia, who put all this together.
And, thank you.
It's amazing how a number of people in the room that you were exploiting in putting all this together, because I know you didn't do it single-handedly, are still applauding and woo-wooing, which is amazing.
Up. I don't know. Yes.
Anyway, they were all great also. And Chip, thank you so much for this. And again, for the... and for the real pleasure that reading your book gave me. I just enjoyed it more than any book I've read in a long time since reading about the Red Sox winning. Did I mention the World Series? And thanking everyone here, every one of you who said so much, and as I said, so succinctly and so well, and we will be going back over it again because I know we taped it and took good notes, and then ImageThink.
Yes, we have them.
Where's ImageThink? Oh, there you are. Those are terrific, and we actually have a blank wall in my office upstairs, outside my office. And you, are we allowed to keep them?
Yes, they are for us. They're for
okay.
you.
They're mine.
Yes.
Do not even try it. And we're going to put them up on the wall tonight. I have people finding the tape. And then it will give me, over the coming period, a reminder of what was just a great, great day. And I thank all of you very much.
Thank you. So, thank you, and we have a reception upstairs, so I hopefully you will all join us for that.
And thanks to the staff.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the...
We can copy the videotape against the bellies.
Yes, we will have copies of those. We will have. We took good pictures of them, yes.
It's a great setting up. Very, very well.